Okay, so how did so you were limping on in your faith, and what happened?
We're limping on.
Would people have known you were limping? Like, would ward members have said, "Well, Sarah's something's wrong with Sarah," or were you able to kind of portray the image of all in, and you were just kind of suffering inside, or some
I definitely was
combination?
all in terms of we were temple going. We had, I Relief Society teacher or Sunday school teacher, we were really active in our callings. But I always have been an outspoken person and I've always been a liberal person. And so I don't think that if I had a conversation, I would deny that things were hard for me. And I think it was around that time, probably a year before we decided to leave, that I started reading The Rough Stone Rolling, which I think, I don't know, I think it was, it just like opened that door more for me. But it wasn't that I read it and then left. I read it and was like, oh, I feel a little better almost. So then we moved to South
How did it
Jordan.
make you feel better?
Just because I felt like I was learning truth. I felt like I was like finally, like someone was straight talking to me instead of trying to explain something away. They were like, no, this is actually what happened. And I appreciated that. That felt really refreshing. But I remember friends seeing me read that book start mumbling like, oh no, like she's about to go off the deep end. They were getting worried, I think, at that point. So we moved to South Jordan, and my husband's parents go on a mission and to Australia, and we are living in their house. And one night, my husband James and I don't remember how the conversation started, but essentially we said to one another that we weren't happy going to church. It didn't feel satisfying anymore to be there. And then one of us said, I don't know if I have a testimony about Joseph Smith. And the other person said, I don't know. Like I said, I don't know if I have a testimony about Joseph Smith. So the plan was, okay, well, let's get to the bottom of this. We're gonna pray, we're gonna fast, we're gonna read. Let's dive into church history and basically decide what we think about Joseph Smith. And then it just is like the spiral downward. And I don't remember exactly where we started, but I mean, I think if you just Google anything with the word Joseph, history of Joseph Smith or something, right? Like you guys know, you did it too. Maybe not, I don't know. And so I think, and it was at that time that I discovered like New Order Mormons. I was like, what is this?
What's a new, for those who don't know, what's a New Order Mormon?
So does anyone want to say? Should I say?
Nuanced, the audience says.
I think of it as somebody who may not believe in the church as a like literally, but they want to stay in the church, right? And maybe because they're married or to someone in the church, or maybe just they care about it or they believe some of it, but there's been a crack somewhere in the faith, but they still want to be involved, right? Okay. So that was like a revelation. I was like, wait a second, there are people who don't believe? I mean, really, like I didn't know that there were people going to my ward who don't believe, but they're going to my ward still. I'm sure there's a lot.
Every word's got him.
So, and then I think we looked up, oh, we read the CES letter. That'll take you down. And a lot of like historical journal entries from Joseph's wives. And I remember one that stood out was I mean, the 14-year-old just stands out because of age, but I think she also stands out because, and what is her name?
Helen Mark Kimball, maybe?
Yes. This guy is a total expert.
Not.
It stood out because I remember reading that she was coerced into it, right? Wasn't there salvation on the line for her family if she didn't do it? And she didn't want to do it, but she was going to do it for her family. And it made me feel so sick. I just remember feeling really heartbroken and really sad about it all. So we start reading, and after a week of kind of researching about the church and Joseph Smith, we decide we do not believe that Joseph Smith translated the Book of Mormon. Like, we believe that he wrote it as a man, not as a prophet of God. The whole, like, foundation of the church kind of crumbles for us as it all is connected, right? I mean, it's hard for one thing to stand without the other. And so we email our bishop and we say that we have decided this is not the only true church and that we are not coming to church again, and to please release us from our callings, and to please not visit us. And he, of course, wrote back and said, please let me come over. Let me talk to you. And I was about to, like, obediently write, like, what time would work? Like, I'm just, like, so... I'm just, like, so trained, right? Like, I'm like, let me roll the carpet for you. It's right in here. And James, my husband, just said, well, do we believe it or do we not? And if we don't, then why do we need him to come over and talk to us? So
taking some power back.
Yeah.
Putting up some boundaries.
So we write back, no, please don't come. Please don't send anyone. And he did. He didn't come. He respected our wish, and... it became very hard because I think in that community, like, every member on our street was Mormon, and they didn't know how to not come to my house in the name of the church, but to come to my house as a neighbor. That was, like, really hard. We became kind of isolated in our street. I did have one friend on the street who, she was just this gift in my life. She really understood my concerns and doubts, and she became like a sanctuary. She was the person that would talk to me every day and really was there for me in a lot of ways. So I hope that everyone has one neighbor on the street.
Are you guys still friends?
Yes.
Is she still in the church?
I don't know what the standing is right now. Mm-hmm. But she knows of the podcast.
Okay. All right. That says something.
But she was very necessary for that phase of transition.
What do you want when you're going through that? What do you want from a friend or from a ward member?
That's
or
a good question.
Sibling or parent? What do you want?
Okay, so I'll give you a few reactions. And I told you this before, but when we left, I wanted to compose a detailed email to send to everybody immediately. Like, let me tell you all the things. I love you. I hope you can accept our children. The whole thing. You're laughing. You did it too, didn't you? Yeah. But I think it felt important to me to declare something. It felt important for me to, like, draw the line and say, like, this is where I stand now. And as soon as I did that, I was amazed at this, like, outpouring of love. I don't know if just I have really compassionate people around me, but I did have some people that were really upset. But I also feel in general that I had many people call or write immediately and say, of course we love you. Of course we love your children. You're always welcome. My mom went to her bishop. She was primary president in Bountiful. So you know how many kids that is. Like a small village of children that she's in charge of. And she asked to be released from her calling so that she could spend more time with me. We were only going to be there a year more. And I thought that was pretty amazing.
This is believing mom.
Yeah. True believer.
But she's like, I'm going to spend as much time with my daughter.
She was like, I want to, like, be
but
in my
not
daughter's
to
life.
Try and, like, no. Intervene or save you or convert you.
No, just to love me. To, like, be with my kids.
It's mom of the century is what that is.
My mom is mom of the century. Yeah, she's amazing. So she was so present and still is. I think that for my mom, it was especially heartbreaking because my other siblings in my family had already left the church. So I was the last hope. And we had been married in the temple. It kind of, like, it had all followed the line that I think they wanted us to. So I know that was really hard for my mom. And then my husband had no interest in telling anybody. He just was like, I'm going to live my life. If someone has questions, they can talk to me. There was no need to declare anything. And I think that's probably the healthier way. I don't know.
You said, like, if he's at a family reunion and he's drinking a beer and someone wants to ask a question, they can ask it, right?
Yeah, he was like, I don't understand why we need to tell everybody. He was like, if I'm having a beer at dinner... and they want to talk about it, like, I'm happy to talk about it.
Bring it up.
But like, why do I need to like jump out and be like, I'm not Mormon, you know? Yeah. So okay. different approaches to leaving. But then comes the long slog of messy work of kind of like starting over.
Yeah. Like yeah. What were the hard parts?
Oh, so we left 5 years ago, and I think initially there's something exhilarating about it because you all of a sudden feel this freedom of I can do whatever I want and I can think whatever I want and I can have compassion and love for whoever I want and wear what I want. You realize how many rules there were, I think, when you leave. Because all of a sudden, no one is like defining what it should look like anymore. So I think what has been challenging for us leaving Mormonism is just recalculating what marriage looks like after leaving. Because James and I are very different people and different interests. And you kind of had this foundation, this floor that you were both standing on very firmly. And then when that's gone, you look at each other and say, like, do we like each other? Like, wait, are you still the person that I choose? Because we're so different. And that was a long time ago that we made these commitments. And like, is this still going to work? And
you had 2 kids by that point, right?
2 kids. Yeah. And so I want to play a song that's about that.
Is that okay? Is that okay, everyone, if she plays a song?
So this was interesting. I wrote this song, it's called Raised That Way, and it's about our experience being raised Mormon and then kind of what it looks like when you look at each other and say, what are we going to do now? But what was interesting was recording this, I have several friends who are still Mormon, and I said something like, we had to go through this big renewal of kind of the choice to be together because we left the church. And they said, oh no, every relationship has to do that. Like every relationship's once you go through having children and through moving and jobs and you're 15 years in and then you look at each other and say like, do we still want to do this? And so I don't think that it's just a Mormon thing.
Is this an alternative tuning?
Mm-hmm.
You're doing it. She's doing an alternative tuning, everybody. That's sophisticated. That means she knows what she's doing. As she's tuning, Esther Perel is a famous kind of psychologist / marriage and family therapist. And she says everyone will have at least 3 marriages in their lifetime. Mm. It will either be to the same person or to different people, but they'll still have at least 3 marriages.
I love that. I think that's true. So this is called Raised That Way. Looking in the rear view about choices we made. We were just kids and we did what kids did when you're raised that way. We had a wedding, flowers and cake. That night you took off my dress and we fumbled through the rest cause we promised we'd wait. And I'm looking at you, you're looking at me. We are different than what we used to be. So please tell me, what are we gonna do? We started a family while you were buried in school. We were just kids and we did what kids did when you play by the rules. The baby kept crying and I cried along too. Put my dream in a drawer. Who would ask for more? Only a fool. And I'm looking at you, you're looking at me. We are different than what we used to be. So please tell me, what are we gonna do? We grew up together and we left side by side, no longer children, so now we get to decide. And I'm looking at you, you're looking at me. We are so different than what we used to be. So now, luckily, now we get to choose. Baby, I choose you. I choose you. Oh, I choose you.
There may or may not be tears in the studio right now. I'm not going to say for sure.
It's debatable.
Couple responses from our listening audience. Rachel writes, CES letter was it for me, and No Man Knows My History. She's talking about her faith journey and how Fawn Brody and Jeremy Reynolds played a part. Lisa writes, to be seen as the same kind person that I am and always have been. Don't judge a book by its cover until you've read the story inside. So she's wanting to be understood. Jenny writes, I wish my family would have asked me why I left. I think those of us that leave desperately wish to be understood. Melinda writes, my husband doesn't need to declare it, but it is important for me to declare it. So she's talking about different people have different needs in that journey. Caleb writes, her songs are incredibly awesome.
Yeah.
So there may or may not be tears in our listening audience as well.
This is really fun for me to share that song here in this context because I don't perform to Mormon audiences that often. And so I think it's powerful to sing a song like that for people who have been through the same thing. So I'm glad you guys are here.
Talk about, was there putting dreams in the drawer? Was there a line about that?
So I have a very like specific memory of James and I had been married for a few years and I was pursuing my career in music and he was going to medical school and we were kind of figuring out how that would go. And then we kind of talked, well, I think we should have kids, not because I think we wanted kids, but just because we're supposed to have kids. And so I remember James was at school and I sat at the kitchen table and I like looked at my birth control for an hour and threw the birth control away and sobbed. I felt intellectually, I knew I wanted children someday, but I didn't have any desire to get pregnant, any desire to have a baby then. And then of course, like, yeah, when you stop using birth control, you have a baby.
Usually.
Sometimes even when you don't use, I mean, sometimes even when you do use birth control, you have a baby. But so I got pregnant and we moved to Seattle and I was in Seattle, which is this blossoming art scene and music scene and so much is going on. And I am losing my mind trying to figure out how to be a new mom. I just feel so overwhelmed and so in the weeds. And I just wanted someone to tell me how to do it right, you know, and I don't know if that's my personality or leftover from the church, but I just felt like there has got to be some clear instructions on how to do this well. And there was none. You know, there's so many opinions about like breastfeeding, formula feeding, how to hold the baby, co-sleeping, you know, all of these things. And I just felt so lost in it all and overwhelmed and also felt like this should be like my true calling in life. And I'm like raising a baby, but I also am having to give up this art and touring and having opportunities that I would have had if I hadn't have had a kid. And I think part of, for me, the journey in the last 5 years is I've really had to mourn that. I've had to mourn that I feel that choices were changed or taken from me because I didn't have all the information. And I've led a beautiful life, and I of course, like, love my children. Like, they're the most important two people on earth to me. But would I have done things differently? I don't know, because I can't go back. But I do think that for a career as a woman, most of the touring female singer-songwriters that I know live in a music city. They live in Nashville or LA or New York, and they are on the road all the time in order to make it a sustainable profession. And so one thing that happened to me in the last even 2 years was I started having this panic of that, like, no one's holding me up anymore. The angels aren't there anymore to make sure it all works out. And I was raised by a single mom, and I just had this fear of, what if something happens in my marriage and I am now responsible to take care of my children? I have two beautiful daughters, and can I do it being a folk singer? And the answer is no, I can't. Like, the joke is that there are hundreds of dollars to be made in folk music. Hundreds. And so this prompted me to decide that I wanted to, like, take power back into my life. And I decided that I wanted to go to nursing school because I wanted to, like, have a card in my pocket that felt like, no matter what, I can take care of myself and I can take care of my kids. And I also, like, love nursing. So it's not just like, you know, it was a wonderful thing to learn, and I'm a lifelong learner. But it definitely, that was the change in feeling that you have a secure net underneath you to feeling that you're on your own in life made me want to be able to have a career, if I needed it, that could support myself.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And that so many women that listen to this podcast are just trying to go through that journey almost for the first time of, like, asking, who am I? Mm-hmm. What do I love? What do I care about? Right. What do I want to do with the rest of my life?
Right.
How do I pick up and have a career or a passion or a profession?
I heard some statistic on NPR that was talking about the baby boomer female generation that's coming up, that so many of them stayed at home, raised babies, their husbands moved on in their careers, and then at some point they split. The husband finds someone else, or they get divorced, and then they are left entering a job market with, like, no skills, no way to, like, make a living, and they're competing against new grads coming out of college who know how to use a computer, and on and on. And I even watched that with my own mom. I mean, I think they sold their house, and after kind of the money ran out from selling that house, she had to get a full-time job, which is why we moved to Utah. And luckily she had some friends in an industry here, but she had no experience in that industry and luckily was able to build a career from it. But I think there's a lot of women who find themselves in a situation where they can't make a living easily on their own once they've raised kids. And I think that is kind of this struggle of being a woman and being a mom, is how to do it all. And I think that women are expected to do it all. And it can be really daunting.
Well, this is great. Juliet writes, amen, ladies, be able to be self-sufficient. Thank you, Juliet. Cheryl writes, beautiful song, rings true. Daniel writes, that's so beautiful, I love it. So the fans are loving the music.
Thanks, guys.
So are we.
Thanks.
So where does that take you? So you've been out 5 years and you got your nursing degree. So what else do you want to share with us about your journey and the songs?
We moved to Wyoming, but before we moved there, I went on...
You did it to pay back loans, right?
Yeah. So there's a great program called the WAMI program, which you, if you come back to your state, which is usually a rural state, and work for 3 years, they'll pay off a portion of your debt. So we moved back to Wyoming, where James is from, to do that. and he goes for an interview for this job. And I've never been to Sheridan, but we go to Sheridan in May, which if you're going to come to Sheridan, come in May or June. It is so gorgeous, y'all. You need to get there. It's just like rolling grass hills and fields. And there seems to be this balance of wilderness with humanity. Like, I can drive 5 miles in any direction from where I live and see pheasants, eagles, antelope, mule deer, white-tailed deer, elk. I mean, everything you can imagine. And so James goes to his interview and I go on a drive. I've never been to Sheridan. And as I'm driving on this dirt road 20 miles, I pull over and there is a lone tree on this hillside. And under the tree is this mule deer, this like stag. My husband tells me that's not what people call it. They don't call it a stag, but that sounds more poetic. So it's this buck under this tree and he stands up and looks at me. But he doesn't move, and I stand looking at him, and red-winged blackbirds are flying all over, like fence post to fence post, and I had never seen a red-winged blackbird.
They're gorgeous.
They're gorgeous, yeah. And as I'm seeing this scene unfold, I find myself just weeping on the side of the road. I'm just losing it, and in my head, I, like, hear the words, there's room for you here. Like, that thought comes to my mind. There's room for you here. And I am crying on the side of the road, like, surrounded by wilderness. And I think what I would equate, as far as, like, spiritually speaking, I think it's really hard to then discern once you leave, like, spirituality in general, right? We didn't really go into that. But I think my husband and I both are people that go to the wilderness to find peace or to find rejuvenation. And when we left initially, we wanted to find another church. I felt like I wanted the structure of a church. So we tried like a Methodist church. We tried a Unitarian church. We tried several churches and nothing seemed to really fit. And so James said, why don't we just start going to the mountains on Sunday? Every Sunday we go to the mountains and we go for a hike and we have a picnic and we take our kids. And it just became this way that we live in the world, and makes a lot of sense to me. So I have this whole scene unfold. There's room for me in Wyoming. I mean, there's physical room, but it also felt like there's room to be whoever you are as this new person. And so I write a song.
So this is the title track.
This is the title track, guys.
Hold from on. Sarah Sample's new album, Red Wing, right?
Yes. And this, my friend Paul Jacobson, who's an amazing songwriter, I sent him this story and I said, we've co-written several songs together. And I said, do you have any interest in helping me write this song? And he said, absolutely. And it took us a year to write the song.
It's a long time.
It is a long time. There was a lot of like, we got the lyrics down first, but then we couldn't find like quite the right melody of it all. And then it finally came together really beautifully. Okay. This is funny too. So as I'm seeing these red-winged blackbirds, I'm like, what is this rare bird? I've never seen this bird before. I was like, only in Wyoming. So I go home and I like Google. And it's like, the red-winged blackbird, the most popular prevalent bird across North America. Like, it's like in every state, in every, you know, like, but I think there's this parallel in that too, where it feels like something so common could be so spectacular. And you just hadn't seen it before. And I loved that. So this is Red Wing. Better if it's in tune. I met God in a high desert sunrise. Neither of us said a word. I found God in the quiet of the golden plains. On the red, red wing songs of blackbirds. I saw a stag in the shade of a cottonwood. He looked my way but didn't stir. He held his ground, now I'll hold mine with the red, red wings of blackbirds. Past the pavement, past the roads, past the world that I used to know. Well, that's where I wanna go. Well, I took my daughters to the woods where their hearts would not be cursed, where they could sail above the trees on the red, red wings of blackbirds. Regret, regret, I've had my share. So many, they all just blur. But I'll burn them bright, I'll burn them fast on the red, red wings of blackbirds. Well, past the pavement, past the road, past the world that I used to know, well, that's where I wanna go. There's hope in the newborn baby and in the driver of the hearse, in prayers and dares and subway fares and on the red wings of blackbirds. Well, someday soon my life will pass, but I've got some living to do first. Still, when it is my time to go, take me on the red, red wings of blackbirds. We're blackbirds singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life you were only waiting for a moment to arrive.
That's my favorite group.
Threw that in.
Yeah, I threw that in. You're doing so much in that song. Oh my gosh, that's a great song.
Thank you. I wrote that song with my friend Paul Jacobson. He's a wizard.
So can we talk about the song for just a second?
Yeah.
One of the things that jumped out at me, you know, part of what unhealthy organizations do, and every organization's unhealthy, so this isn't targeting Mormonism. And I'll say as another disclaimer that I think Mormonism can raise wonderful people, does raise wonderful people. So it's not that the church can't do that. But one of the things unhealthy organizations do is they send you messages of fear around what happens if you leave.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the main binding things that keeps so many people in the church and that kept, frankly, Margie and I in the church for so many years is like, well, you can't raise a decent human outside of Mormonism.
Mm-hmm.
And that just keeps a lot of people in. It's like, if I don't raise my kids in the church, they'll become, you know, crack dealers and prostitutes and homeless, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the things you say in that song is that for you, your leaving the church was an act for your daughters. Is that what I heard you say in the song?
Absolutely.
Talk about that, because I don't think we're condemning Mormonism as an unfit place to raise children. But for you, why was that important?
Well, I think it's really dangerous for someone to think they have all the answers. I think that's a dangerous idea. And so I think when you are raising children and you have the answer for everything, then what, like, where is their curiosity? Or like, how are they going to think through things or decide for themselves eventually something? And so I love not knowing. I don't know. I'm so happy I don't have many answers now. Like, it gets so simple to me once we stepped away from Mormonism that, like, I want to teach my children to be good people, to love others, to treat people with respect, to do their best, you know, like really simple things. But I don't have to have all the answers, and they don't have to either. And frankly, they shouldn't. They shouldn't have all the answers to everything. So I feel like, you know, when my daughter comes home from school and says, so-and-so said I don't believe in God, and what is God? I can say, well, God has a lot of different names. Some people call God Jesus. Some people call God Jehovah. Some people call God Buddha. Some, you know, and we get to talk through the ideas of that exist within society without there having to be a right or wrong answer. And one thing that I've asked my mom to do, because she is Mormon, I don't want her to pretend she's not Mormon or to lie about what she believes. But I ask her to preface it with, well, this is what I think, but there's a lot of different ideas about it, you know, or there's a lot of different ways to feel about it. This is one way to feel about it. Because I want my children to, like, be open to the wonder of it all and to not feel they have to know everything.
Yeah. What was the line about driver of a hearse? Did I hear that right?
Yeah.
There's beauty. What's the line?
Yeah. So there, let's see. There's hope in the newborn baby and in the driver of the hearse.
How is there hope in the driver of a hearse?
I just think, like, I love transitions. I'm just so drawn to, like, the vulnerable parts of life. And I feel like, and Paul came up with that line of there's hope in the newborn baby and in the driver of the hearse. And we talked about it. And I love the idea that, like, we're all going to die. Like, we're all vulnerable. And there's something really beautiful about a new birth in the world. And there's something equally beautiful about somebody passing on to the other side of it in the right circumstance, you know.
Do you, and it's okay if this isn't the time to answer the question, but do you, so what are your beliefs now about a God or an afterlife? Or do you?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. And I don't, I'm not, like, seeking to know. I just want to be present in the world and show love to my fellow man and be present for my children. I'd keep it pretty simple.
We have someone wanting to clap over here. You can clap. All right. Beautiful. Yeah.
So can I have another idea I want to talk about, which is, have you guys ever heard of kintsugi? Kintsugi is...
sounds Japanese.
Yeah. So it means gold joinery is how it translates. And it's the process of, like, when pots or pottery would be broken, that they would repair them with enamel that was lined with gold because they wanted to show the break. And the break became part of the piece and a beautiful part of the piece, and highlighting it, like, made the piece more valuable. And so I've thought often about this idea of how this transition out of Mormonism, I want to be that. I want to be the broken parts are lined with gold and something that I can comfortably talk about and engage with people, and that it doesn't have to be this, like, shameful or hidden part of my life, but it's like accepting the whole story. I don't want to pretend that I wasn't raised Mormon. I'm very grateful for so many parts of being raised Mormon. But I also don't choose that for my life. And I think there's a beauty in the breaking. So I want to play a song about that.
And it's called?
Heart That Falls Apart.
Okay. Off of Red Wing.
Mm-hmm.
Sarah Sample's new album at sarahsample.com. Check her out tomorrow night, Friday, 7 p.m. at...
The Post.
The Post.
The Post Theater. Right. Please come. And you know what?
University of Utah. Right?
Yeah, University of Utah. There's different ticket prices. Honestly, if you just show up and you're like, I just have to see this girl in person, like, my mom will probably let you in for free. You never know.
Shout out to Sarah's mom.
Yeah. I do have the best mom. This is actually about my mom in some ways. So my mom is a crier. Anyone here a crier in life? And I was really embarrassed as a kid. And then the gene activated in my system. And then I became a crier.
You had an epigenetic moment.
Yeah. And all of a sudden I was a crier. So I cry at things that are sad. But I also just cry all the time. So I cry at almost every movie preview, like, that I see.
Preview.
Yeah. And, like, you know those Olympic commercials, the Visa Olympic commercials? The worst. Like, they get me every time. And, like, nature documentaries, whoever narrates, you're like, oh, these penguins, you know. It's like, I heard there's a new March of the Penguins coming, so I'll be crying at that. But I believe in vulnerability, and I believe in telling the whole story, and like the pottery being broken, I think there's something really beautiful in breaking. My mother has a tender heart. They say I got the same one right from the start. Some people get their daddy's laugh. Well, I got a heart that falls apart, splits right in half. I'm not the steady arc, and I'm not the solid ground, no shoulder to lean on. But I'll give a heart that falls apart, a heart that falls apart. Oh, you'll never cry alone when I'm around. I wish that I could draw that line, but it's not the way this heart was designed. Enjoy your sorrow, everything. Well, I got a heart that falls apart in everything. I'm not the steady arc, and I'm not the solid ground, no shoulder to lean on. But I'll give a heart that falls apart, I'll give a heart that falls apart. You'll never cry alone when I'm around. I say let it come, all the waves of sorrow one by one. I will sink by your side, and then I'll pray the moon to change her tide. So when we feel the sun, our two hearts will have become one. I'm not the steady arc, and I'm not the solid ground, no shoulder to lean on. But I'll give a heart that falls apart, I'll give a heart that falls apart. Oh, you'll never cry alone, you'll never cry alone, you'll never cry alone, you'll never cry alone, cry alone, cry alone, you'll never cry alone. when I'm around. Thank you.
All right, let's get some comments in. Melissa Wells, one of my childhood friends growing up in Houston, Texas, Katy, Texas. She was an important part of my youth. She came out as lesbian, post-Mormon, decades before I ever questioned the church. She figured it out early. She was in Austin last time I heard, but she says, going to buy Sarah's CD now. Thanks for sharing. So sarahsample.com, support this wonderful music. Lisa writes, how many children will find themselves lost as they grow due to being trained who they should be? If we would just let them soar and fly their own journey in life, let them take different roads, let them create a beautiful journey of their own. How do we become our true selves if we aren't given the chance to write the story?
I love it.
That's good, Lisa. That's good stuff.
Yeah.
You should become a songwriter, singer-songwriter. Melissa writes, there's hope in all of it. Nice. In the song with Redbird, what is it?
Red Wing.
There's kind of a universalistic message there about there's beauty in everything, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that a part of what you're saying?
There is.
Yeah, that reminds me of the song Holy Now by Peter Mayer. I don't know if you ever heard that song. You heard that? Sam writes, great song. Darren writes, beautiful. Jenny writes, no matter our relationship to religion, I think we are all looking for a place we feel that we belong.
I love it. Thanks, guys. Thanks for listening. Can I read a poem?
You can do whatever you want. I mean, within reason.
Dance party?
Don't say that. Are the songs over?
Well, I mean.
No.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how many more songs I have left. But.
Oh, well, just you keep going until you're done, because we're not done until you tell us we're done. And then we're done. And then we'll have lunch.
Yeah, I think we're pretty close to being done. I mean, unless I would love to see if any of you have any questions. There's always like more to the story, and I don't want to leave anything out if you feel there's something that you're interested in knowing. So as part of my concert, I've incorporated two poems. I want to read one of those poems that goes back to the idea that wilderness can kind of become a church. So this is a poem by Wendell Berry called The Peace of Wild Things. When despair for the world grows in me and I wake in the night at the least sound in fear of what my life and my children's life may be, I go and lie down where the wood drake rests its beauty on the water and the great heron feeds. I come into the peace of wild things who do not tax their lives with forethought of grief. I come into the presence of still water, and I feel above me the day-blind stars waiting for their light. And for a time, I rest in the grace of the world and am free. Go Wendell Berry.
Yeah, Margie loves Wendell. If Margie loves it, I'm a fan. Margie loves Wendell Berry. So yeah. You and Margie need to hang out.
I want to.
So why'd you read that?
I think that it just is essentially the heart of this record. Is I do feel despair often in the world. And I feel like when I don't know what else to do, then you need to step outside. Look up at the stars. Turn off your phone, see some wildlife around you. I think that is a really centering thing to do.
Has that become your divine, so to speak?
I think so, yeah. It definitely is for my husband. He is a big outdoor enthusiast and is, when I met him, like rock climbing, whitewater rafting guy, light, you know, marathon runner. So he definitely makes time to be in wilderness every week. But I think that's one of the great lessons he's kind of taught to our whole family, is that's a really good way to get your heart back on track.
I love it.
Yeah.
Any questions? Just one sec. Just one sec.
Just curious what life life is like in Sheridan? How diverse is that area, or is it still very LDS?
You know, no, it is not LDS at all. And it feels really wonderful to, I feel like that was a really important step for my family to take, is to move out of Mormon culture. Because now we get to just be people, you know, there's no one wondering if I'm going to church or am I Mormon or am I not Mormon. The only Mormon that I know in Sheridan is my dentist. I'm sure there's more, but you really just get to meet people for who they are. And it's interesting because I find myself when I'm in Utah, I start making assumptions. Like if I see someone and I can see a garment line or I think they might be Mormon, then I'm already assuming that I know what they think about things. And so I'm not gonna have the same conversation that I would as if I knew nothing about them. And the other thing that's been really good for us living in Sheridan is it's a very conservative community. There isn't a ton of diversity, but I am very liberal leaning. And so I've, instead of being surrounded by like-minded people, I'm able to have people I really love and care about. And we disagree very strongly on some really big issues. And I think that's important to have those conversations and to be put in places where we're forced to talk through things instead of just say, well, my side's over here and we all agree and you guys are over there and you all agree. I've had some really interesting conversations over the last few years because I don't agree with everyone around me. So that's been a good lesson for me.
Yes. And then just one comment is, I'd never heard of your music before, but I love finding new music. And I think I've listened to Red Wing probably 30 times in the last 2 days. I think my spirituality is music now, and your music really has been a revelation.
Thank you.
Truly enjoyed all of it. So,
Jeff, what are some of your favorite songs and why?
Red Wing, just the whole overall message, because I connect with that, yeah, with finding the spirituality in the outdoors and in music and in new places.
Yeah.
And also the dance song. Aww. I had to pull over in my car because I relate to
it. You love Michaela.
yeah, but I also had a rough dad. And so I come from a different angle because my mom would say, learn from this and don't be like this. So I was very purposeful. So I'm kind of flipping it, but mm-hmm, I put everything I could into being a good father and that I didn't have, and that just really touched me. So
thank you.
Yeah,
thank you for listening.
Thanks, Jeff.
Yeah.
Any final questions? You got to have at least one more. We'll take multiple unless you're done, and then that's okay too.
Let me think.
And you can play something from a previous album if we have to, you know, we have to have the encore where we're like all like flashing, lighting the lighters and like clapping. Ooh, do we want another song from Sarah? Ooh. Yeah, you can't just get off easy. Unless you want to.
Because
you're in church.
This is a song that I wrote for my daughter, June, when I was starting to kind of get back on the road touring. And it was really hard to leave. And yet it also felt this really important part of me that I wanted to nurture and to say, like, it's okay to go like play music and come back to your little fam. But I wanted to write a song to my daughter that is essentially a love song when you have to leave.
And is this on Red Wing or?
This is on an album called Someday Someday.
Okay.
But all of my music is on iTunes or my website or Spotify, so you can.
And the album this is on is?
It's called Someday Someday.
The album?
Yeah.
And the song?
No, the song is called Every Time I Go.
Okay, Every Time I Go.
Yeah.
And is this your final song?
This is my final song.
All right. You guys, this is the final song by Sarah Sample. You can check her out at sarahsample.com. She's performing tomorrow night, Friday, June 15th.
Yeah.
7 p.m. at The Post.
And my whole band is coming.
With the band.
And they're so great, you
so
guys.
Don't think it's that just because you listen to this that it's you've got the Sarah thing. Sample experience. Yeah. Special kudos if you go and you're a Mormon Stories listener.
Yeah,
I'll
tell
take
me.
I'll take you to ice cream if you go see Sarah.
John, I want to say before I end, thank you so much for all you do for this community. My husband and I listened regularly. We just devoured your podcast. while we were transitioning out. And your voice is so familiar and wonderful, and I'm so happy to be here.
We love having you.
And thank you all for coming and taking a chance on the folk singer. And to Cody, and Tim,
and Amy.
Thank you.
To our donors and supporters.
Mm-hmm. Every time I leave, I feel like I am free, falling real slow. My stomach in the sky and my heart a battle cry. Yes, you have won me over. Every time I go, I give my heart to you to keep you from the nothing, no, nothing, baby, could keep my love from you. And when you cannot hear me whisper in your ear that you are my lucky star, and the bully in your mind is saying words unkind so loud that you start to hear it. Every time I go, well, I give my heart you from the cold, whisper on truth, then nothing, no nothing, could keep my love from you. Well, give a kiss, come on, please, another. Who grants the wish to stay forever in my arms, in my arms, in my arms. Every time I go, I give my heart to you to keep you from the cold.
That's sarahsample.com on Spotify, on iTunes, at sarahsample.com. I'm just going to read one little comment from Melissa Wells, again, someone I grew up with in the Mormon Church in Katy, Texas. She writes, I referenced her earlier, she writes, still in Austin, still lesbian, and to her point, have raised an incredible young man outside the church. Ironically, my father's last blessing, and her father was my Sunday school teacher and youth leader for many years. The last blessing he gave literally on his deathbed was to Melissa's son. Although all Melissa's siblings have left the church, her dad, who passed, being a firm believer, showed her son what unconditional love really is. So thanks, Melissa, for joining us. Thanks, Sarah, for this wonderful music. Summer Peterson writes, "Hi, Sarah." I think you know her. But please share Sarah's music. Please take this post on Facebook and share it on your walls. Please tell everyone to buy Sarah's music. It deserves that. We need to support our artists. So spread the words. Share this episode with family and friends. Please show up at all Sarah's performances and send her your money.
Thanks, John.
Thank you so much for spending time with us. And good luck with this new album. Tell your husband and two daughters we want to meet them someday.
Yeah. And I want to go on a cruise. That sounds really fun.
All right. Bahamas. Well, we'd love to have you. You can perform.
There you go.
Yeah, bring some CDs. You can sell them. This has just been lovely. Thanks to everyone who's joined us. And sincerely, thanks to Tim Corey, to Cody Layton, and to Amy Grubbs for making this morning possible. Thanks to our live studio audience. Can I give my studio audience an applause? This is super fun. I want to do this again. It just kind of brings a fun spirit here. We sold out. All the seats are taken. We're sold out. And thanks to all of you who support Mormon Stories Podcast. If you don't support the Open Stories Foundation for Mormon Stories, donations are tax deductible. We're financially transparent. And they go towards supporting people in transition. That's what we do, in or out of the church. So please support us. If you do support us, thank you. If you don't, you can go to mormonstories.org, click on the donate button at the right, top right of the page. 10, 15, 20, 100 bucks a month, whatever you can afford, allows us to keep doing this. And we will keep doing this until you stop supporting us. That's how the deal works. And then we'll go do other things. How does that sound? But in the meantime, thanks to everyone who keeps this stuff alive. We're going to be doing more of this kind of stuff in the weeks and months ahead. So please email us at mormonstories@gmail.com. If you're a singer-songwriter, you can send us your songs and we'll put them in our bumpers. And if you're coming out with the album and it's worthy, like this one is, like Red Wing certainly is, we'll have you tell your story and sing your songs right here at Mormon Stories Studio. Anything else you want to tell people if they want to support or follow you?
No, I do, though, want to just make a plug for the arts in general, which is that we live in a day and age where technology has made it so easy for people to create music and art and photography. But because of that, people have started accessing all of the arts for free. And therefore, people who buy music, like most people I know have subscriptions to Spotify. But artists don't really make any money from Spotify. And so you can have millions of plays on Spotify and artists are not getting that money. And so if you have Spotify, that's great. But buy the CD too, or go on iTunes and purchase music. Purchase the things that you care about. Put money where your mouth is. And like John said, you know, this same thing with a podcast, that if you listen and if you care, it's so important to show up financially to support the arts and to keep them alive.
And if someone just wants to send you money, can they just send you money?
No, I don't really do that.
Put a PayPal button up. Sarah Sam, it's called PayPal.
I don't know.
I'll do it for you.
I've never done a donate
Send
button.
Sarah money.
But what I do, I do love to play house concerts across the U.S. So if you want me to come sing in your living room, I'll come do
okay,
that.
Okay, so you're for hire.
Yeah.
So if you want to bring Sarah Sample to your home and do a party, a house party.
Yeah, a listening concert.
How do they reach out to you?
So just you can email me. It's just sarah@sarahsample.com. You can access that on my website too. But I love connecting and I love people and I'd love to come sing for you.
And your songs are amazing and you deserve to be like a global sensation.
Thank you.
What's happened? The world's not right.
Well, I mean, that's a long answer, but
that's another podcast.
That's another podcast. There's a lot of people in the river right now, all competing for the same minuscule nothing. So,
well, it's not for lack of talent or
thank
heart.
You.
So thank you, Sarah Sample. All right, everyone. Thanks for joining us. Take care. And we'll see you again soon on the Mormon Stories Podcast.